When you modify your suspension, afterwards, we always recommend getting an alignment. Now, what is an alignment? You take the car in, you get a sheet back with a bunch of numbers on it. So what do those numbers mean? I know a lot of people are confused about them. Today, we're talking about the basic parameters of an alignment, including camber, caster, and toe. So we're going to start off by discussing camber. Camber is the vertical angle of the wheel in relation to the vertical angle of the body. So basically, with the side of the body using this RC car as an example, it's going to be the angle of the wheel. So let me remove the body here to get a closer look at what the wheels are doing. So like I said, camber is measured as an angle. So zero camber, your wheels would be perfectly up and down. Negative camber, the top's going to be pushed in. And positive camber, the top's going to be pushed out. Now, for most applications, you're gonna want negative camber. Now, a lot of people think, well, zero would be perfect because my tires are gonna wear evenly. The problem is cornering. When you go into a corner and the car is turning, it's gonna put a lot of stress on this outside, which makes the wheel roll over. So if you had zero camber, when you go around a turn, it's actually gonna go outside on the tire and wear the tire unevenly. Giving yourself a little bit of negative camber means when you push the car into a corner, you get the flattest part of the tire and get the best contact patch. So obviously on your average street car, you're gonna want some negative camber because again, when you're pushing into the corners, you want the flattest contact patch. Now, how much is too much? Well, whatever car you have, whether it be a Mustang, whatever else, there's gonna be alignment specs set up by the manufacturer for that particular vehicle. But if you use the vehicle for different purposes, you might want different alignment settings. Now, let's look at those cambered cars. You've all seen them, the wheels tucked in like this, barely on them. That's obviously too much negative camber. That's being done for looks, for fitment, whatever, but it's not really safe because you're using too little contact patch and you're gonna wear out your tires. Now, if you're talking about a car that's set up for autocross or road racing, you're gonna want more negative camber because again, that car's gonna spend a lot of time pushing into the corners. Drifting is gonna be the exact same way. It's a little bit different though, because basically they have a lot more camber in those wheels because the wheels are turned so far. When you're drifting sideways, you want that lead wheel to have more contact patch, and it's gonna have a lot of strain on it, which is why they want more negative camber. Now, if you get back into drag racing, you want closer to zero camber because your front wheels, you want to have as little rolling resistance as possible. So the more shit up and down you have, the better it's going to be. Now, when talking about camber, we talked about the front, but it also affects the rear if you have an independent rear suspension car. Basically, it's the same kind of rules as the front. You want a little bit of negative camber. So when you lower the car, you'll actually see you're going to get negative camber automatically. So if you lowered your S550, these wheels will tuck in. Now, we do have camber arms that'll make that adjustable so you can average it back out, and there is a little bit of adjustment in the factory. Basically, you don't want to have too much negative camber though, because as you go down and the car squats even more, you're going to get too much on this inside tire. So you want to control the camber in the rear of the car. And again, there's camber bolts that can do that. There's camber arms that can do that as well. But the lower you go, the more you're going to lose that. You got to remember when the car also pushes forward, it's going to lift that rear suspension too. You don't want to have too much positive camber because it's going to push the car outward. So again, usually with the back of your Mustang, you want just a little bit of negative camber, which will balance out with the ride height and the force of the car moving forward. All right, so we talked about camber. Now, what is caster? Caster is a little bit more difficult to explain, but basically caster is an angle based on your steering pivot joints. And if that angle is backwards, it's positive, it's forward, it's negative. So imagine this car had a steering column. Our steering joints are like this in the car. So if you shoot straight down and that angle would go in front of the tire, that's gonna be positive caster. If an angle went back behind the tire, it's gonna be negative caster. Now, all of your street cars are going to have positive caster, basically because if they didn't, they'd be nearly impossible to drive. We're actually gonna leave the table here. I'm gonna show you another way to really kind of explain how it works. So one of the easiest ways to show caster is honestly with a bicycle, because everybody's ridden one and understands how they work. Now, if you look, you can see the fork, which would be the steering components of the bicycle, is facing forward and away from the steering wheel, which is the handlebars in this case. So what that means, that is gonna be positive caster. So you can see if you follow this down, that will actually go in front of the tire, to be front of the contact patch, which is gonna be positive camber. Now, for steering to work properly, you basically need positive camber, but too much isn't any good either, and we'll get to that in a minute. But here we're gonna give you a quick demonstration of positive versus negative caster. So we've all ridden bicycles back in the day, and you know, if you're like me, you loved riding your bicycle, and you could probably ride no-handed. The reason you do that is positive caster keeps the steering firm. When you roll the bike forward, it's gonna go nice and straight. But when you pull it back, you can see it immediately tries to turn. Do that again here. Get it balanced, go forward, it goes straight. When you come back, it's gonna try to turn. So basically, when the bike is moving forward, you're getting positive caster in your steering. When you bring it back, you're getting negative, and you can see it makes it want to turn sharply. So the reason you want positive caster in your Mustang is basically so the car goes straight down the road. So just like with Camber, when you get your car aligned, whoever does that alignment is going to have specs from the manufacturer for caster. Now, caster won't have as much adjustment as Camber does, but you will have some, and they'll be able to dial that in. Now, you don't want too much caster, which is why they limit it, because the more positive caster you get, the looser that front end is going to feel. It's going to make it harder to steer as well. So definitely, it's one of those things that you want to have set up within the factory specs that'll make the car a lot better to drive. So the last parameter of alignment we're gonna talk about is gonna be toe. And just like Camber, toe has a lot to do with tire wear and how well the car actually drives. Now what toe is gonna be is a measurement of the wheels, whether the front of the wheel is forced inward or forced outward. So you've got toe in when the wheels are in or toe out when the wheels are out. So basically in a perfect world, your toe would be even. You'd have no toe in, no toe out, your toe would be set at zero. But if the car ever turns or ever does anything, that's just simply not gonna work. So if the car is towed inward, basically the front of the wheels are gonna tuck in and point inward like this. If you have toe out, it's gonna be adjusted outward like this. Now again, depending how you use your car and also depending what drive lines in your car is gonna depend how you wanna set up the toe. Now for most of your street cars, you're gonna want a little bit of toe in. The reason being is toe in is gonna make the car basically ride nice, perform well, and have minimal wear on tires. Now, if you're talking about a road course car or a drift car, in that case, you want to actually have a little bit of toe out. It's going to make the car turn faster. And with those cars, you're pretty much drift. You're always going to be sideways. And road courses, you're turning most of the time. So having that toe out will make the car respond a lot faster and make it handle better on the track. Drag racing, again, you're shooting for zero toe because the goal is to go straight with as little rolling resistance as possible. So you want to have it at zero. Now, I said it's going to matter on your drive line. And as far as setting up a car, front wheel drive, rear wheel drive, and all wheel drive, you're gonna set the toe a little bit differently. So in a front wheel drive car, these front wheels are gonna basically pull the car. So what happens is they tend to pull inward. So when you're setting up a front wheel drive car, you wanna set it with a little bit of outside toe, so when you're getting traction pulling the car, your toe changes inward. Rear wheel drive is gonna be the exact opposite. Rear wheel drive, you're pushing the front end. As you push it, it tends to go outward. So you want to set a little bit of toe in, so when the car is pushing, basically the tires even out and go back to closer to zero toe. Now, all-wheel drive is going to be completely different. In a perfect world with a perfect all-wheel drive car, you'd want the toe set at zero. The problem is, most all-wheel drive cars are going to have a dominant axle, whether it be the front axle or the rear axle, so you want to set them up similar to a front-wheel drive or a rear-wheel drive car so they react accordingly. Now, obviously, like I said, we discussed three parameters being caster, camber, and toe of alignment, and basically we gave you the very, very basics. There's a lot more to it when it comes to chassis setup, especially for race cars and stuff like that. But now, at least, if you get your car aligned, you get that sheet back, you can take a look at it, you'll know what those numbers mean.